Good evening and welcome to our Pasco County School Board meeting. Now would be a great time for you to check your cell phones and make sure all electronic devices are turned off. Our vision statement is all students achieve success in college, career, and life. And I have the thought for the day, and I did this one especially for our CFO, Olga. I thought she would appreciate this one. It said, "Balancing a budget is like going to heaven. Everybody wants to do it, but few want to do what you have to do to get there." And if you had been through the last 4 or 5 months to know what it takes to get there, you would appreciate that. So with that, we'll stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let the record reflect that all board members are present along with our superintendent and our attorney tonight. And I would ask you to join us in a moment of silence and personal reflection, and especially for those that are ill and suffering tonight. I know I've gotten 2 more phone calls today from family members of people that have been hospitalized. And so as that goes, I'd ask you to remember those in our community that are suffering. Thank you. Board members, we were provided the minutes of our last regular meeting on July the 20th. If there's no changes, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Armstrong, second by Crumley. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes. Thank you. Tonight, we do the public hearing on our tentative budget, and I'll turn it over to the superintendent.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. Tonight, the board is tentatively adopting the 2021-22 fiscal year budget. You're required by law to adopt the millage rates, and once these millage rates are adopted, the district will certify them to the property appraiser to begin the notice to residents for the upcoming tax year. And additionally, the district is required to certify the adopted budget to the FDOE. That said, the 21-22 tentative budget is $1,466,165,077, a decrease of $53,503,834 under last year's budget. The budget includes a general operating budget of $731.5 million and a capital budget of $351 million. The total tax millage for the 2021-22 fiscal year is 5.810. That's a decrease of 0.112 mils. Under the proposed rate, a homeowner of a $175,000 home, after the deduction of the $25,000 homestead exemption, would pay $16.80 less per year than last year. The general operating budget increased from $704.4 million to $731.5 million. The district received additional funds totaling $10.5 million in state funding to accommodate our projected growth of 2,277 students and recurring expenses. Out of the $10.5 million, $8.7 million is set aside for school choice, that is charter schools and scholarships. $2.5 million of that is for retirement costs. $2.1 million for health insurance increases, and approximately $1 million for property insurance, utilities, and SRO contract increases. The budget includes a reduction of 24.93 school and district allocations for a reduction of $854,744. The operating budget covers allocation and operating costs for the opening of Starkey Ranch K-8 and the mid-year opening of Kirkland Ranch Academy of Innovation. The budget also includes an allocation of $1,573,117 to continue to increase the minimum base salary for full-time classroom teachers. As it relates to the capital budget is $351 million, a decrease of $50.5 million under last year. The largest capital project appropriations are for the construction of Kirkland Ranch Academy of Innovation, the construction of the 612 Academy in the Land O'Lakes area, and major renovations for Hudson High School and Gulf High School. Other projects include cafeteria renovations, replacement of HVAC systems, and infrastructure upgrades. The 2021-22 budget also reflects fiscal priorities, which prioritizes the support and support student achievement and sets aside funds to provide a COVID retention supplement for employees that meet certain service criteria. We're looking forward to recognizing those employees that were with us last year and continue their service this coming school year. This supplement covers those employees that are not covered by the state supplement requested by the governor. Additionally, this budget is designed to ensure the smooth delivery of effective school operations while prioritizing the needs of our students and community. As you all know, the budget is certainly a living document and continuously changes as the year progresses. Budget amendments will be submitted to the board to reflect any changes to the budget document once adopted by the board. That being said, Mr. Chairman and members, I'm respectfully requesting your approval of the 2021-22 tentative fiscal year budget as presented. And before we take public comment, I'd like to turn it over to Mrs. Swenson, our CFO, to step through the budget and how we balance the budget for you this evening. Ms. Swenson?
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Superintendent. Good evening. I'm happy to report that we have a balanced budget for you tonight. You've seen this one-page summary, and I'm just going to walk you through the changes that were made in the last 2 weeks. The biggest change is we did get additional money from the state. The second calculation was released July 16, and we did get approximately $1.5 million more, mostly because the property taxes went up about 12.4%. Most of the money that's coming new to us is local money. The budget was built on about 6% property increase, but we actually saw a 12.4 increase. The next item that we change, I believe I brought this up to you last time, but I want to go over the biggest changes was to the retirement increase. That amount was revised based on all the payrolls we processed. Our charter school projected enrollment, we based it on 944 FTEs. And of course, we mentioned the scholarships, that those are my best estimates at this time. We really do not know what's going to happen with the scholarship. We will monitor that and let you know how it's going. The property insurance, software license, and utilities, those did not change. Going on to the additions to the budget, when you approved the budget, the allocations back on June 15, you approved about 2.62 units decrease. And you can see the school allocations was a reduction of about $521,000. For the district allocations, it was about a $209,000 reduction. Since then, and I believe next board meeting, we're gonna submit additional allocations and reductions we have made. The net school allocations will be 1.5 units, which is about $303,000. And the district allocations will be 20.81 units, and it's an increase of 179,000. And I know it's kinda odd, but most of the cuts were student cuts, so they're worth less money than the other allocations. But you will see that when we submit the position control forms to you. And I can provide a detail if you would like. The next item that was added to the budget is what the superintendent mentioned. We set aside $5.5 million for COVID-19 retention supplements for employees that would not qualify under the governor's bonus plan. We finished insurance benefits. Right now we are planning for about $2,062,500. But I can tell you that is coming in higher. Our June claims were higher than what we expected. So this number is going to, not sure which way it's going to go, but is the claims are coming higher right now. The SRO contracts are done. I mean, finalized. The net increase for that was $62,000. We are moving 30 custodial units to be paid with the Department of Health grant. We are also moving the school psychologist. 35% of their salary is being moved to the mental categorical grant. It's not a grant, it's a categorical funds that we get. That still has to be approved by the Department of Education. I believe we're submitting the plan this week. The district discretionary budgets did not change since last time, nor the school discretionary budgets. The total fixed cost, as you can see, is about $18.2 million, and we were short about almost $12 million. Our proposal to balance this budget is by using our flexibility, which is allowed by law, of using instructional materials funds to use for this budget, and we will bring the resolution to you next board meeting. The reason we're doing that is because we use ESSER funds to purchase all of our textbook adoption. So that allows us to use this money for this year only. It's non-recurring, it will not happen again next year. The same with the property insurance. We're transferring approximately $4.5 million from the capital funds to the general fund to be used for this year only. It's again non-recurring. And the last item is based on my best estimate at this time, and this number will change once we finish closing the books. But right now, I'm projecting that we have about $2.5 million of recurring fund balance. So that allows us to balance the budget and all the needs that we had for this year.
So the other day, we were short one municipality on the SRO contracts. Did that get finalized?
Yes.
And that's included in this number?
Yes.
Okay, so we're done with all of them?
We're done with them.
Okay. Thank you.
The custodials that we're using for the health grant, they know that that's only for, what are we going to, what's going to happen when, if we need them the following year?
We'll pull them back into the general fund.
Yeah. Okay.
And we know that.
Yes.
Yes.
Can you explain the district allocations again?
Which?
Well, because how you said it was down 20.81 units, but then the number is up 179,000. You said it was mostly students.
There's about 27, and I'm remembering for that, and I'm looking at Kevin, but I believe there's 27 district BCE students that were not being used, so we basically cut their those allocations. It was at the district level only, not at the schools.
And those were positions, Mr. Chairman, if I may. Yeah. Those were positions that we checked with district departments first, and they were positions that were not filled. They have never been filled in large part, and that's a sizable chunk of money. And I'm sitting there thinking, why do we need to keep these positions on the budget, particularly? And this does not reflect well in the district, but when you can go to McDonald's and make $15 an hour. We're not yet paying $15 an hour. We're moving towards that because of the minimum wage amendment. But we thought it was the right time to pull those allocations.
And they were ones that we weren't using.
That is correct.
Right.
That is correct.
Any other questions?
Did I explain?
Yeah.
Thank you, Ms. Swenson.
Oh, and before I leave, I'd like to just call out my team back there that have worked very hard on the budget. I'd like to thank them publicly.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Michelle and Janie are back there, but the entire staff team from finance has been working hard on this.
No,
so
and
thank
we
you.
Appreciate all your thank efforts
you.
So much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, just a comment.
You want to do it now?
Or later?
We're going to take public comment.
Okay, No. Well, I'll do it when we have the resolution, yeah. Never
okay.
mind. I'll wait till then.
Mr. Attorney. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ladies and gentlemen, this is to announce the public comment portion of the first of two Public hearings on the District School Board of Pasco County budget for the 21-22 school year. The second and final hearing will be held on September 14, 2021 at 6 p.m. Notice of this public hearing has been posted on the district website and in publications in compliance with Florida Statute 1011.03. Any member of the public who wishes to be heard on the budget should have already completed a speaker request form, but may still get one from the board secretary. If you do so, will you please approach the podium when your name is called, state your name and address for the record. Each speaker will have 3 minutes to speak unless an extension is granted by the board chair. So ladies and gentlemen, this is a public hearing, and this is your opportunity to be heard on this issue. If there's anyone who's present and wants to do so, now would be the time to come forward. Mr. Chair, board, on the budget? Yes, ma'am.
Well, it's part of the agenda items. Is that part of the budget?
No. It's not. It's just a public hearing on the budget at this time. On the budget. This is the public hearing on the budget only. So if you're present and you want to be heard on the budget, now is the time to come forward. Other than that, let the record reflect that no one approaches. And to your point, there is an opportunity for public comment on agenda items in just a few minutes and non-agenda items at the end of the meeting.
All
thank
right.
you.
Thank you. So board members, we have three actions that we have to take on the budget. First one is to adopt the tentative millage rate resolution.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Armstrong, second by Bodwin. Any discussion? All in favor signify by aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Second is to adopt the tentative budget resolution.
I move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Crumley, second by Harding. Any discussion? Mr. Armstrong?
No, I'm going to wait till the very end.
Okay. All right.
Go ahead.
All right. So we have a motion, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. The third one is the set the final public hearing date, which has already been advertised, to September 14th at 6 p.m. in this boardroom. We'll take a motion and a second.
Move to approve.
Second.
And I would like just to make a few.
I don't know who did that.
Motion by Crumley, second by Harding. We'll let Ms. Armstrong make a comment.
All right. I just want to make a few comments about the budget. I know this is the tentative budget. But I just want people to be aware of a few things. One is how hard the district really works to put this budget together to make sure that it is a financially sound budget, a budget that we as a board members can be confident that they're doing everything to spend the taxpayers' money wisely and to spend it in the right places. But with that said, you know, it's something that we're going to have to, you know, look at in upcoming years, even as close as next year, because you can see we did use a few recurring, non-recurring funds to balance this budget, which is something that none of us like to do, and so that just means we're going to have to really dig in hard next year, unless the financial situation improves. I can only say, thank goodness, property values went up. Or we really would have been hurting, because if you look at comparing this budget with last year's, the money from the state that they give us was less than what we received last year, even though the year before we had gotten more money than the year before that. So we'd been on an upward trend, and despite what the legislature, how they spin it, when you look at the actual numbers, we actually got less from the state legislature. So that those are issues we need to be concerned with, because as we all know, the property values will not continue to go up at the rate that they're going up. So just kind of a cautionary thing, I just want you to know that we're, as stewards of taxpayers' dollars, we're aware of all these things, and we will be looking at all that carefully to make sure that we stay very financially sound and keep our rating, credit rating high, so that we can borrow with as little cost as possible. But I do want to thank the staff and everybody that's worked so hard on this budget to bring us something so clear and concise that we know exactly where we stand.
Thank you. So board members, we had a motion and a second. Any additional comments? Not all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. So this is the closure of the tentative budget hearing for 2021, and we move on to special presentations, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Island.
I am pleased to introduce Principal Cadlip to come up to the podium in order to talk about one of our outstanding teachers in Pasco County that teaches at Pasco High School.
And just so you know, she has no idea why she's here. She trusted me enough. Just ask her to come with me tonight, and she trusted me enough. And she literally has no idea why she is here. So, yes. So, and there's a lot to say, so I apologize. I typically don't like to read, but I don't want to miss anything in regards to her. So, it is my pleasure and an honor to introduce to you Ms. Tamika Bowens. Tamika graduated from Pasco County. She graduated from Pasco High School in 1991. She then, after college, decided to come back to Pasco County, where she started her teaching career at Wesley Chapel in 2000. I was honored to meet her at that time, and I actually got to teach with her in 2000. It was geometry. I can remember exactly where we were and what building we were in. Monica was our assistant principal at that time. And so she then later transferred back to her alumni, to her alma mater, to Pasco High School, and that is where our paths crossed again. So she has been at Pasco High School. She has taught a wide variety of math courses, but within the past few years, Tamika came to me and she asked to really want to focus on our struggling students. She teaches all of our algebra students, all of our Algebra 1 and Algebra 1A students. So this year, she is actually going to be leader of our algebra team. So I'm super excited to bring that on board. Not only, though, to talk to you about Tamika inside the classroom, outside in our community, this is where I gotta make sure I read all of this, she is a huge community standout. She is part of the Pasco Hernando Center of Excellence, houses the College Reach Out Program, the National Achievers Society, which was formerly the McKnight Achievers Society. She's part of the Believers Program. She was inducted into the McKnight Achievers Society in 1987. She joined the Center of Excellence staff in 1998 as a math instructor for the Summer Enrichment Program. The program has expanded to include college Saturdays during the school year. The program uses Khan Academy to allow for differentiated instruction to build math skills and to develop proficiency. Tamika is also the head coach for the Math Brain Bowl, where teams have placed first, second, third at the 9th and 10th grade level and the 11th and 12th grade level. During the most recent competition, the 11th and 12th grade team was eligible for full tuition scholarships. Her team received scholarships for FSU, USF, and UT. Tamika is here today being recognized for her outstanding work through these past 2 years, through all of these difficult times. Tamika was not accepting that her students were performing below what she was satisfied with. She made a plan all by herself, came to me and presented her plan to me and made a plan, individualized plans for all of her students. And I will tell you, at the end of the year, over 90% of her students passed their algebra course. So I am extremely proud that she gets to work for me, and she trusts me enough that she's just going to come to a school board meeting. Never been, and she comes with me. And so I just want to acknowledge her, and it is an honor to work alongside of you. So.
The microphone is hers first.
Oh,
yes.
If she wants it.
Because I had the honor at graduation while we were waiting on weather to have a discussion about at-risk kids, and she is so passionate and had such great information. I know you have something you want to say. Hate to put you on the spot.
I am on the spot, but I get put on the spot all the time with my College Reach Out program. When I started teaching, I was teaching the lower level math students, Algebra 1A, 1B, discovering geometry, and I just fell in love with teaching that level of students. And as I went on in my career, though, I started teaching some of the this honors classes and some of the at on-level student courses. And I just miss teaching the lower-level students. And so I kept putting in my name to teach Algebra 1 and 1A, and they would never give it to me. Someone spoke up on my behalf, and Ms. Cadd was like, "Are you sure?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm sure." And so I came back in, and we kind of revamped the whole Algebra 1 system. We weren't able to last year, but the year before, we set it up to where we shared all of our students, all three of us algebra teachers, we shared all of our students, and our goal was to make sure that these kids were successful. And in our first quarter, when we took our benchmark test, the kids did phenomenal. Our group of Algebra 1 kids scored, we had a 33% pass rate, which was the highest we've ever had at that school for Algebra 1 on a benchmark test the first quarter of school. So we were really excited, and we went full speed ahead with our plan, and we shared our clique kids, we mixed and matched, and we had good outcomes, and we were really sad because we couldn't do it again last year, but we came up with a different plan, and it worked. And I was, you know, I did it all on my own because I didn't know if they would be willing to go the distance and that I would be willing to go. And so I took it upon myself to just, you know, make some changes. And I was part of the MyGrad Success team at school, and, you know, for the last 2 years. And I just, you know, I wanted the kids to know that, you know, it is possible to succeed. And so I went all out and I did what I could to help that, or to help make that happen for them. So I trust Ms. Caleb because I've known her for 20 years. Our daughters went to preschool together. Our daughters my daughter is in between her daughters age-wise. So there's Kelsey, then my daughter, I'm sorry, Jordan, then my daughter, and then Kelsey. So I don't, she asked me to come, and I didn't know what I was coming for, true enough. but like I said, I've known her for over 20 years, and I trusted that, you know, she had my back. Whatever it was, she had my back.
Well, she obviously trusts you.
It's an honor to be here. I really wasn't expecting any of this at all.
Well, you are the first teacher from Pasco High to be recognized as we started this program, so I hope you recognize how much they appreciate you and how honored we are that you are here today and what you do for our students, especially in our alma mater.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you for indulging us in that. So we move ahead. We have no off-agenda items, so we go to public comment on agenda items only. I'll turn it over to the attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the opportunity for the public to be heard on items appearing for action on the agenda night. To speak at this time, you should have already completed a speaker request form and given your name to the staff at the lobby. If you have any materials or documents you wish to share with the board, please email them to the board secretary for distribution after the meeting. Each statement made by members of the public will be limited to 3 minutes in duration once per meeting, and I serve as timekeeper. Please keep your eye on the little monitor there about the time. Speakers will be called to come forward by the board chair. Prior to making your remarks, please state your name and address for the record. All speakers and comments are subject to applicable school board policies regarding civility and decorum. Thank you.
Thank you. So speaking on agenda item 10.4, Chelsea Strong.
It's Chelsea Starr, and my address is on file. So with 10.4, it's the mental assistant allocation plan. And when looking over this plan, there's some things in it that concern me. You're using the company Cognito. I don't know if any of you have looked at the Cognito Corporation. It's not about therapists working. It's about AI simulations, where on one hand, I can see that would be helpful, but it's not necessarily. If you're having kids that need therapy, you don't give them a computer simulation. If you're training people to talk to kids, you don't give them a computer simulation. So these are so-called experts talking to our children, but on the Cognito website, it says conversations with virtual humans that change lives. Cognito forms diversity, equity, and inclusion advisory groups for higher education. There's that lovely word, equity, which means everybody wins, everybody gets a prize, everybody comes to an equal standing no matter how much you try. Now, I don't know if you've looked at who underwrites this company, but of the companies that I looked into, 80% of those companies were very strongly LGBTQ plus supporters. Look, I don't have a problem with somebody's race. I don't have a problem with somebody's sexual orientation. I grew up in theater. 90% of the people that I worked with have been gay my entire life. That's never been my issue. My issue is when you have so many issues and curriculum that are being taught to our children that are about LGBTQ issues all the time. You wonder why there's so much of an issue with child suicide and with kids that are having problems. Well, perhaps it's because the curriculums that you're teaching our second and third graders about how to have anal sex and how about being non-binary, different things like that, which is in the curriculums. So they're confused about what their sexuality is and what they are, and then they go to school and they're supposed to wear masks where they can't see their teachers, they can't see the people that they're with, and then they're quarantined for several days at a time. How are kids supposed to have connections with their teachers, connections with their students, connections with other people if they don't have the opportunity to have those things in front of them? And you're confusing them all the time with the different LGBTQ curriculums that you're doing. Mental health is great. Mental health is something that's needed for our kids, but it's like you're causing the problem, action, solution. You cause the problem, and then you tell them that they can't deal with it. And then when the quarantines that are gonna be coming up, and you're talking about quarantining non-vaxxed kids, but not quarantining vaxxed kids, that's called segregation. That's also going to cause some pretty acute mental problems for our children, because they don't know why are they being quarantined and I'm not being quarantined. Why am I being quarantined and they're not being quarantined? That's segregation. I thought we covered that in the 1960s, but I guess we didn't. So please look over this company that you're choosing. What you choose for your students means a lot. And if you're talking about their mental health, you need to talk about all of their mental health, not just a company that's convenient because it fits all of your boxes and works in with what you want. Thank you.
Mr. Peace.
Superintendent Browning, Attorney Alfonso, Chair Altman, honorable board members and district staff, I hope you're all well. It seems like I was just here a week ago, so I'll be brief. Saturday, August 7th, we will be holding our annual rep rally at the Hilton Garden Inn here in Lutz. We are expecting over 100 building reps to take part. It's our annual meeting to disseminate information on the return to school to our building reps. And this will be our first face-to-face meeting in over a year, so it's kind of a big deal. Toward that end, we would invite you to attend if you're available. If you are interested, please contact me and I'll give you the information. We continue to work in the background preparing for our first official bargaining session. There's much to talk about this year as we seek to return to full-time brick and mortar and allow face-to-face interaction between students and their teachers once again. I believe both USCP and the district have the common goal of striving to return to rigorous study in the classroom and move our students forward educationally as they prepare for college, careers, and life. We will continue to converse with senior staff regarding the expenditure of ESSER funds as it pertains to helping reduce class size, provides additional and or remedial instruction, and help maintain a safe and healthy environment for both students and employees. We do have some concerns regarding the health status in Pasco and the upward trend in positive COVID cases. Towards that end, earlier this evening, I gave senior staff a health and safety MOU for both the instructional and SRP bargaining units. It is imperative that we create an environment that is conducive to students and employees functioning in the safest possible conditions. We look forward to working with staff to make this a reality. Amidst all the challenges of a new school year, we're optimistic that together we can make this school year one to remember. Thank you for working with USEP.
Thank you, Mr. Peace. Committee board reports, and I'll start. I didn't have any this past week. Thursday, I'm in Lake Mary for the Preferred Insurance Trust meeting all day long. So, Ms. Armstrong, you want to go next?
None for me.
I didn't have any meetings since last week.
Same here.
None for me.
All right. So, Mr. Superintendent, we'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Let me just start out, well, let me just give you an update. I want to thank Mr. Gabb for sitting in for me during the last meeting. I was watching online while I was out of town, and we did have a meeting with the County Health Department yesterday. Mr. Napier, the director of the County Health Department, had brought a good number of his team members with us, including his epidemiologist, and had a large number of my staff in there as well, because one of those things, kind of hear it from his lips to our ears. I know there's been a lot of questions about quarantining, and I'll address that in just a minute. I did want to reiterate, since I have the floor right now, as far as masks goes, I will say once again, masks will remain optional for students that choose to wear masks, or parents that choose to have their children wear masks in schools. The optional mask usage also goes for our staff as well. So that issue has been settled. The governor has taken that issue on as his issue. The governor has made that decision. There is no local decision making regarding masks. And he has said that there will not be a mask mandate. We understand that. As far as quarantining goes, I think that was the main issue that staff wanted to talk about yesterday, because we know that it is probably one of the more problematic issues or more challenging issues, pressing issues, as you see COVID numbers dramatically increasing. He said over the last 2 days of statistics, it was a 25% positivity rate in the county. I know that before that, it was sitting around 19%. And while I was on vacation, it was sitting around 12, and then it bumped up to 15. So it is on the upward rise. I saw some data yesterday that was pretty staggering when you look at where we are today with COVID cases, and we are about the same place we were in December, which is frightening, if you will, particularly as we approach the start of a school year. So as far as the quarantining goes, and I would have my staff chime in and correct me if I misstate anything, but the quarantine rules will remain the same. I want it understood by the board and by the public that the quarantining rules are not made by this superintendent, this board, or the superintendent staff. The quarantining rules are set by the state. They're the health experts. They're the ones that we have and rightfully would have taken medical advice from since the very beginning of the COVID situation in March of 20. They drive that ship. That is their wheelhouse. It's not mine. They're not doctors, medical doctors on my staff. We don't profess to be doctors. Anytime we make decisions that are that have a medical leaning to them, we will always reach out to our county health department because they are the professionals. So we asked about the quarantining, and he told us that until he's directed from the Florida Department of Health in Tallahassee by the Surgeon General, Dr. Rifkes, that the quarantining protocols will remain the same. Those protocols, and Ms. Musselwhite may want to correct me if I do misspeak on this, but the way I understand it, is that certainly symptomatic cases, all symptomatic cases, will be sent home for 10 days. Then it gets down to if you're vaccinated or not vaccinated. If you're not vaccinated and you have come in contact with a positive case and the health department has made the determination that you'll quarantine, then you will quarantine. If you are vaccinated, and come in contact with a positive case and you are asymptomatic, not showing any signs, then you can remain in school, both either as a student or as a teacher. There has been some discussion about, well, we're creating two tiers of two classes of individuals. The fact remains that we take the direction from the State Department of Health. They're the ones that set these rules. We do not set these rules. Contrary to what may be posted out to social media, either Facebook or Twitter, or different groups that may be out there that say that the school district is trying to do this, that, and the other to our students, that's not the case. We do take our marching orders as it relates to medical issues from the county and the state health departments. So until something changes at the state level, then that will be the quarantining rules. I will tell you that we have received the Florida Department of Health grant, that we are hiring LPNs and RNs to do the contact tracing. These will be contract nurses with the district paid for by the grant. They will be housed on our site, and there will be little to no involvement of school staff and district staff in that process. I said little to no involvement with that, because I was very clear, and even on a sidebar conversation with Amy Ponce today, our supervisor of school health services, I said, I want to make sure that you, because she's been working the candle at both ends on COVID cases, because we don't have anything set up before the start of school, that I want to make sure that our school nurses are in fact back in schools doing their jobs as school nurses, providing health services to our kids. Our kids went almost a year and a quarter without, all practical purposes, health services. And I know firsthand, having my wife being a school nurse, I know what school nurses were doing as far as contact tracing and COVID cases. So we're getting our school nurses back into what they're doing, and that's providing school health services to the kids. So we will continue to keep the board informed as things change. I will tell you, even today, the CDC comes out and makes a recommendation that all individuals, when they are inside of a building, whether they're vaccinated or not, should be wearing a mask. That, at this point, I'm just saying doesn't apply to us, but until the governor says that we will wear masks. He will make the call on that. That decision has already been made. So with that, we will keep the board informed moving forward on to where we are. We met all day today. We met all day today, my staff and I. And a good part of that was just going over COVID protocols as far as athletics and fine arts, and distancing and protocols, cleaning, everything that we went through at the beginning of last school year. as we're preparing those final documents to see where we are and how we can get this out when we get it out to administrators and teachers, so they know what to expect when they come back into school. So with that, I'd be more than happy to take any questions. I will tell you that there's still a number of answers that we don't have yet. But this process is not unlike what we were facing a year ago, that things are continually changing. I did not think that we would have the positivity rate that we have today, 2 weeks ago, but we do. And we're monitoring that, and we're working with the County Health Department.
Mr. Chair?
Go ahead.
Okay, ma'am. I hope that we're advocating, though, that healthy kids need to stay in school, because we all know, as I spoke last week, that putting our kiddos on a computer, especially like our kindergartners, even up to our high schoolers, without a teacher, not being in school for 10 days, however long quarantine, especially if they're healthy, is not what's best for them. I'm worried about their academic success and their mental health. Last year, we had to make a lot of tough decisions, and it really hurt a lot of our kids. I'm getting a lot of questions from teachers now that if they have to quarantine, what is that going to look like for their classrooms? I know Kevin had just mentioned that if they can work at home, some of them might be able to Zoom into their classrooms. But now they're worried about their sick time, so now they're being forced to go home, quarantine for 10 days. Is that going to take from their sick time? I know last year we gave them some sick time. Another question that I have, I know Vanessa talked a little bit about this last week. What is online school going to look like? Last year, no fault of teachers' own, it was hard for them to keep up with Canvas courses, and I did look at the reopening plan, and it mentioned that they might not even, the courses that they're going to take online might coincide with what they're learning in the classrooms. That's only going to push those kiddos back even further. I've had parents contact me, they just don't even know what this is going to look like, so I think it's really important that we get that information out, because there's a lot of misinformation going out there, and this is what's best for kids. We need to make sure that our kids are in school, that are healthy. So I don't know if you can answer any of those questions. Another question I had was activities. I'm getting lots of questions about what's that gonna look like, sports, the arts, volunteers in the classroom. So there's a lot of still, we have 2 weeks left of summer. Administrators aren't even being told exactly everything that they have to do. And I understand y'all are working so hard, and I'm so grateful for that. But this information needs to get out there. So I don't know if you can answer any of those now.
We let all the board members.
Okay.
Those are just some of my concerns.
Okay.
Go ahead. You're ready. Go ahead.
Well, first, thank you for all the work that you've been doing. And I called Mr. Napier, too, and he did reiterate, I'm sure, the same thing he said to all of you. But I feel like we're being put in the position of having to be like spokesmen for the health department. And, you know, really that's not our job. I've talked to Attorney Alfonso a lot as well. I know we're trying to communicate information, but I wanted just a straight answer of what are we required to do? There's no emergency order by the state surgeon general or the commissioner of education or the governor that's currently in effect, unless that changed today. Now, what Mr. Napier said to me was that he's following state statute that in general about infectious diseases. And I wanted to, so it's not really COVID related. This is how they handle infectious diseases always. And I wanted to confirm what that state statute was with Attorney Alfonso and how that applies to what we have to do as the district. What information do we have to share? And then what happens if, because the health department's doing the quarantining, we're not doing the quarantining, our staff, and you've made that crystal clear. So the health department calls a family and it's then on them to follow the quarantine. We shouldn't be involved with that part. That I wanna know what we're saying our responsibility is. What do we have to do? Attorney Alfonso, can you? I know we've talked a lot. Then do you want me to say the thing about, I had something about masks too, just that we just want to make sure that, like you said, it's a choice, and I'm getting emails from parents and teachers, actually, both sides, of course, but just the fact that it is a choice and that whatever people choose, we want to make sure that kids or nobody's getting picked on for whatever their choice was. That's the main thing, is that these are personal decisions that people are making, and we want to try to keep that from anything bubbling up in the classroom and causing disruptions.
Yeah, I had a lot of similar comments to my colleagues. I just want to reiterate, and I know you're working on it, but I think it's important that we get the picture to the parents as soon as possible what the quarantine is going to look like for their kids. I think that's the biggest question of all that I'm getting, is what and if the quarantine is going to look like, as far as how are they going to continue with their education if they're quarantined.
I think they've covered it all.
And I'm too, so you want to address the...
So that sounds like I'll give the short answer, right?
Well, I mean, you've told me a lot, but I want to make sure the public hears,
yeah,
too.
It's important that the public knows.
So I hope to at least, update the board and the public as well. The specific question that was asked by Ms. Bodwin and other board members privately was, you know, if I could look at the law, what is the statutory authority for this process of investigating disease, infectious diseases. So we have talked about, a lot of this was covered by the emergency orders, the executive orders that came out back in March of 2020. They are all originating from a statutory source, which is Florida Statute 381.0031. And that's the specific statute that generally authorizes the health department to investigate and follow up on, epidemiological issues. There is also a little bit harder to find, but also equally relevant, a Florida Administrative Code provision that is 3-041, that puts out greater detail about what the authority of the health department officials are. So those are the two statutory things. They're really long. The gist of them is to confer upon the health department those responsibilities for investigating, following up, and entering such orders as may be necessary in their realm and their discretion to deal with those issues. So that's kind of where at least their authority lies, as I understand it, and I certainly can't say it as efficiently as the superintendent, but I believe for the time that I've been here and heard this discussion, the district's position has always been that it's the health department that actually does the health functions, the contact tracing done by the health department. What we do is facilitate access to information which is required by law, because this is all non-FERPA protected directory information that is given as requested to an agency that's doing an investigation within their authority. So that's the district's primary position about that. The secondary position is, it is, as the superintendent has said in the past, and as far as I'm aware, it is really the health department that really dictates the rules about what is and what isn't appropriate quarantine information and response, as I know I experienced when we had those issues arise at the board level and appear. And so they've always been consistent and directed by the health department rather than by this board as to it developing its own individual policies. That's probably hopefully responsive if you have any other questions.
So we really need to be like talking to the state about this. Is that what you're saying? Just talking to the state? So we should be... We should be writing emails to the state, writing to is it the Surgeon General, or is it the head of the health department? Is that what they're...
The governor.
Yeah. Governor. Yeah, okay. It's the governor.
Yeah, after
because
having...
I think we need to be very clear if we are going to, and I've sent an email and I'll send another one about the hardships that this is going to put on our district. But, I mean, we want to make sure everyone's safe. Don't get me wrong. But the effects it's going to have on our healthy students, our healthy kids. And what that's going to look like when they're home for 10 days, and how much extra work we're having to put on the districts to ensure that our students that are healthy and are at home healthy, the work that they're going to be missing out on, even though we're trying to do everything we can possible, I get it, to ensure that they're learning, it's still not just not the same as if they're in school.
I think everybody would agree.
So,
Mr. Chairman, if I may, let me address Ms. Harding's comments, and I will tell you that there, and we had a conversation today, as I did with Mrs. Crumbly, there is no one in this room, I shouldn't say that because I know all of them in here, for the most part, I know for the staff, that doesn't want kids to be in school 180 days, period, new paragraph. We do everything known to man, particularly when it came into COVID, on how to make sure that there was a continuity of instruction for our kids. Mm-hmm. Let me just reiterate the point that the reason that My School Online is not going to be an option next year is, quite honestly, the state is not funding it. And I think I shared with somebody today, I can't remember, talked to so many people, I'm caught between this whole conundrum of making sure that we provide that world-class education to every student, while at the same time, I've got to try to balance a budget and make sure we have the resources to provide that world-class education. And when the state tells you that they are not going to fund that innovative learning environment like we had last year, then that becomes off the table. We were one of the first districts out of the gate this year at the end of last school year says, we're not gonna have it. Why? We had districts around us saying, why did you say that? Well, I said, why are you prolonging the inevitable? The fact of the matter is the state has said they're not gonna fund it. So why can't we go ahead and just let the parents know we're not gonna have that option next year because the state's not funding that option next year, and then we as a district can plan about what that's gonna look like. There is probably a great deal of agreement that we are concerned as a staff about the academic success of our kids. I mean, when you sit in any of our meetings, before COVID, during COVID, and I'm sure after COVID, we spend so much of our time talking about the academic success of our kids. That is what we're here for. We are to provide that world-class education to ensure that they are having every opportunity to be successful. The mental health component, my goodness. I could have Ms. Musselwhite come up here to the podium and talk about all the different aspects of everything that we have done as a district before, during COVID, and I'm sure will continue well after COVID, as it relates to providing mental health services to kids, particularly not because of COVID, but it was as a direct result of what happened after Marjory Stoneman Douglas on February 14th of 2018.
I'm not saying
No, I understand.
Okay, I just want to make sure. I'm just worried about.
I am very concerned about it because where we had parents that would tell you, my child is thriving on My School Online, I have data to prove to you and to them that their children were not thriving on My School Online. What it was an option for them to keep their kids in a safer, what they believed, a safer environment. What did we find with COVID over the last school year? We found that kids were not getting COVID in our schools. They were not. We have data to show that kids were not getting COVID in our schools. Where were our kids, our students, getting COVID? They were getting COVID at the ball fields, at Boy Scout meetings, at church, every place but school. Now, same can't necessarily be said held true about the adults that were in our school buildings because they were sharing their fair amount of COVID throughout the school year. But they, too, were getting COVID from outside and bringing it in and spreading it. The thing about it was that what we found interesting is that last year during quarantining, and we quarantined a great number of kids, I mean 30,000+, and some of those were duplicates and triplicates. Yes. I understand that. When I say we did that, the county health department, but we were much more intimately involved with that quarantining process last year than we are going to be this coming year. So, but we are still taking our direction from the county health department. And I would venture to say that a very, very small, and this is anecdotal, but a very, very, very small number of kids actually got sick from COVID. So we want our kids to be there. We did not create COVID. You did not create COVID, and the public did not create COVID. It's the hand that's been dealt to us. And I think somebody said today, it sucks. It does. And there's no other way of getting around it, but it does. But it is a bad disease that radically impacts our day-to-day lives And particularly when it comes to education, we are trying to provide that educational platform, those opportunities for kids to have that type of education that they're entitled to. It's not easy. It is not easy. We spent a great deal of time today talking about the nuances about what, and this goes back into some of the things that you asked about activities, about what does athletics look like? What does fine arts look like? We made some decisions on that. We're going to put it in a document. We're going to pretty it up. Dr. Riles led that discussion today at our staff meeting, and we're going to get that out to administrators. We're going to communicate it to parents. I think the message we want out to parents is we're not doing the quarantining. The county health department is guiding or directing the quarantining. We don't make those rules. Believe me or don't believe me, I'm telling you the truth when I say that we're not doing the quarantining. Our goal, our mission is to educate kids and to provide them that very best opportunity. To Ms. Bodwin's point about being the spokesperson for the Florida Department of Health or the Health Department, you know, I think I can say until I'm blue that we're not doing the quarantining, but regardless of where we find ourselves with COVID, this district is going to probably be the mouthpiece because it's their kids, it's our system, and we're going to communicate or be the one to communicate where we are with quarantining, where we are with masks, and but we say it over and over and over and over again. And we'll have to keep saying that. I was talking to Steve Hegarty a little bit this afternoon, and it was just about continually repeating that message because there are folks out there that will read Facebook, they'll read Twitter, they will either read it and not believe it or miss what we've posted out there. So we're continuing to let them know what's going on. Let me also assure you that kids will be kids. Kids can be mean, and kids can make fun of each other. And so when it comes to, oh, you're in a mask, my mommy says I don't have to wear a mask. Is that gonna happen? You betcha it is. You betcha it is. It is, why? Because kids are kids. Now, what is our role and responsibility? Our responsibility is to nip it in the bud and to use it as a life lesson, and then let's move on. Because it's not about the mask wearing. If a parent chooses to keep their child in a mask, that's fine. You're probably gonna see me in a mask here pretty soon if things keep going the way they are. I think that we need to provide those opportunities the best we can. When it comes to the actual day-to-day education of those kids, there is no perfect system. There is no perfect system. We're trying our dead level best to make sure that if a child is put out on quarantine, that they are going to have some continuity of instruction. And can I guarantee that it's going to look just like their classroom? No. I will tell you right now, it will not look like their classroom. There are going to be opportunities for some of them to zoom in, zoom out, zoom up. I don't know what they're doing. But the fact is, it's not like sitting in a bricks and mortar classroom with a great teacher standing in front of you. And I just want this board to know that these folks that are sitting out here today have just, and directors, so we had directors in the meeting for most of the day, are just, because every time we turn around and we make a decision, we rethink that decision. And I told them today, I said, let's look. That's right. It's changing. It's changing. But I say, now let's look at this decision from outside the district. What's the perception outside the district? Because parents look at things differently than what we look at them. And we don't have all the answers. That's the reason when it comes to the medical issues, we rely so heavily on the Department of Health.
And I think it would just be helpful maybe if I understand what you're saying. We all want to share information, and I'm trying to share information. We're all trying to share. But it may be because sometimes that information is coming from the district, they think it's there. People, the perception is, since we're putting it out there, that we made this rule. If there's a way to link to whatever the health department is putting out there, that might be a more direct, where we're still getting the information.
Well, they're not
out,
putting
but it's
anything
coming
out
from
because
the
they've
right
been
source.
Forbidden yeah. of putting things
okay.
out in writing.
So
it's all verbal.
They get verbal instructions that aren't allowed to be publicized. And
yeah.
Can I add something?
So you're talking about the quarantining and stuff?
Everything. No.
Everything.
Yeah. Everything. I ran a state agency for 5 years. I know how it works. And if yes. you think a state agency director runs a state agency, you're sadly mistaken. Everything it's is coordinated the through the plaza, exactly. which is the governor's office. I mean, yes, I'll just stop
so
there.
We need to just keep...
Yes, and we do.
Remind the governor's office that we need backup, we need help, because it's
turning into the district is doing this.
We had a call yesterday with the Florida Department of Education. My staff was on, my team was on it. Spoke for half an hour, talked a lot, said nothing. Yeah, said nothing.
So I'd like to add something.
They did say something.
They did?
Which is, when we ask them about quarantine, they said, that's over there in the Department of Health. We don't have anything to do with that.
They won't put it in writing.
That's right. And I will tell you, the last thing I'll say, and then I'm gonna stop, and then I wanna go into something else.
Okay, well, I have something to add. I'm the polite one.
Go ahead.
Okay, I'm just gonna add that last week, something was said by Mrs. Musselwhite that it was, you were not here, so this could be very helpful to this whole overall discussion. We're looking at putting in place more rapid testing for the students as well, which could, in fact, shorten, perhaps, the quarantine time.
There is a...
So these are all pieces that we are trying to put into place, because obviously, the shorter the quarantine, the better.
There is a rapid PCR test.
Yes, and based on the conversation last week, this is where some of this grant money is going, that we're gonna have this ability, maybe not day one, but as soon as we can, to enable the students as well as teachers to have this quick PCR, which would really shorten up the quarantine time.
Yeah,
that's a very important piece.
We did discuss that with the health department today, and
don't tell me he didn't like it.
No, we're looking at it, but there are problems with it. And the biggest problem is that they have the rapid PCR test, but they only have one machine. And so it takes about 20 minutes to do a rapid PCR test, so you can do 3 an hour. And so they've ordered more machines, but as you can imagine, all over the country, these machines are being ordered. So the rapid PCR, you can have thousands of them, but if you only have one machine, it doesn't help you very much.
Well, and then there are probably other locations they could get this done, too.
Yeah, that's correct.
So and then, like I said, not day one.
And Dr. Napier has made that clear to us, that they are advising everybody to go to their private providers, federally qualified health centers, community health centers. But we did discuss the six-day quarantine. Doesn't solve the problem, but it gets kids back in school a little bit sooner. But until they have the equipment they need, they can't possibly make that work.
Right, so let me...
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to wrap it up with one final comment.
That's fine.
I do have one more question. I'm sorry.
Okay. No, go ahead.
Do you have any information on the teachers and if they have to quarantine, what that's going to look like with their sick pay? Is that wrapped up yet? Do we know what that's going to look like?
It's coming out. We nailed it down
today.
It's
a worry for a lot of teachers I've heard from.
It's coming out soon.
Oh,
we nailed it down today.
And we worked on some ideas relative to that today. One of the things that Ms. Scalise is going to be doing is meeting with USCP later this week, because those impact working conditions. Those are not things that we can just set unilaterally on our own.
Okay.
So Kathy is going to have to meet with USCP on some of those ideas. I will tell you, when we planned reopening for this year, almost all of our summer planning was for a different situation than we are in now. We had fully planned for a normal opening of the school year. And then unfortunately, 2 or 3 weeks ago, we start to see surging numbers in Florida and in Pasco County with the Delta variant, which kind of altered our thinking a little bit. Mm-hmm. So the original plan really was, the expectation was that it wouldn't be a big deal and the majority of our employees would have been vaccinated. And when we had those off cases, then the employees would use their sick time. We're now anticipating being in a different situation, and so we are looking again at how do we allow flexibility for staff to work remotely in certain circumstances, and when they can't work remotely, how do we provide them some protection that doesn't eat away at their leave? So those are things that we will be talking about with the union. We just can't commit to them unilaterally, or it's actually considered an unfair labor practice, and we could get ourselves into
totally
trouble.
Makes sense.
So,
and with that, just to reiterate, we know everybody's working on this.
Yes.
Every aspect, and we appreciate it because it does change.
Yes.
Well, and additionally, you need to know that the procedures that you're going to see are going to be considerably looser as opposed to tighter than they were last year. So as it relates to use of facilities, athletics, various events, they're going to be looser. It's only in looking back whether or not we'll know that's a mistake, but going forward, we're going to loosen up a little bit. so that folks can attend ball games and dances and things like that. So the procedures will be considerably looser than last year.
Mr. Mead, you'll share
until
this.
We're told otherwise.
Anytime we make a decision like that, we like to let it simmer for just a little bit, and then we circle back around.
Until it changes again.
Yeah, it will come out soon.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I am grateful.
So I'm on. Close that and move on to something else with a couple of comments.
I like the math.
That, do what?
I like the math thing earlier with that wonderful teacher. It was so happy.
we'll get back to that. Huh?
I have one more issue.
Go ahead.
Well, I'll finish up and then give it back to you.
Yeah. Because I may have to clarify something you say.
Okay. You might have to clarify what I say. the last thing that I wanted to say tonight was most of you know that tonight Peggy Faceman.
I thought you got another comment about.
No. No, this
no.
I have one more last item.
All right. Then I'm going to finish up the COVID deal. And then
go ahead, and then I'll put you on the spot.
So my comment was is that I was talking to somebody today in a business that employs about 130 or 40 people, and similar to what this district has done, they've gone through all this planning and had all of this stuff, and 2 weeks ago they thought they were in great shape, and today they're not, dealing with lots of issues that are impacting their business. And my comment to him was, is that 2 weeks from now, it'll be different again. Mm-hmm. And so people just are going to have to be patient and understand that flexibility is going to be key, because none of us control it. And it literally is changing not only for the school district, but the employers of these parents, mm-hmm. and their situations and what they can do are going to change for everybody. And so I'm sure this board has been adamant tonight in their appreciation for all the efforts that have gone into it. I happen to know a little more maybe about the hours that some of them have put in, because I've been bugging them so much on stuff, and I apologize for that. But literally, it has changed almost sometimes on a daily basis. So we will continue to address and share information as quick as we can. So with that, Mr. Superintendent, move on to something
surprise.
Else.
Surprise. Yes, I will move on to my last topic. Most of you know that tonight is Peggy Fixmeyer's last board meeting.
No.
Say it ain't so. She doesn't always have roses sitting on her desk. Peggy's retiring. Friday is her last day. And as I shared with staff yesterday and with Peggy, I said, you know, when Peggy announced that she'd be retiring July 31st, that was such a long way off. It was so far off. And then it just got closer and closer, and now it's here. And Peggy is the consummate professional. I will tell you, and I think board members would agree with this, she has made us look good. And she has covered up a lot of our, not covered up is a bad term,
yeah.
But she has soothed so many of our rough spots and the way that this district operates. When I first came to the district as superintendent in the interim between being elected and taking office, she was one of the first gals that I met, and she treated me with the utmost respect and professionalism. And I will tell you, although Kathy Hunsinger is here, and Kathy's gonna do a great job and has huge shoes to fill, and we'll quit talking about Peggy on Monday when she's not here, but this is Peggy's time. Peggy is, I'm going to miss you, and I've told you that. There have been days where I would just go plop myself in front of her desk, and she'd be in the middle of something, and we would just talk.
And she'd have to take away the sharp objects.
She'd have to take away the sharp objects, but we would just talk. She had an ailing mother who's since passed away, who I knew very well in my younger days, and we just commiserated, and we just talked about moms. I have a 94-year-old mom, and we just sit there, and we just talked. And it wasn't about work. It was just about life. And I'm going to miss that. And we're going to miss you on the third floor, and this district is going to miss you. I'm sure this board will have something to say, but they will miss you as well. And we just wish you the very best of your retirement, in your retirement. I know that you're I was going to say your better half, but I'm not sure that's true, is here tonight. Mike Facemeyer. I've known Mike for years and years and years. So he's here. Mike, thank you for being here supporting your great bride. So thank you.
Pictures.
Thank you. I love you. I love you more than you know. So thank you. Best. Every moment?
Oh, wow.
Most every moment.
Most every
moment. I must tell you, Vicki Herring makes me look good because of the words from Vicki Herring.
No. Well, we...
And our passion is longer than she is.
So staff knows this, but others would not know that we're the largest school board in the state of Florida that doesn't have staff member for each board member. And our board secretaries have done yeoman's work so much more than what anybody could ever know, because we run such an austere, budget conscious deal. And so Peggy and the other ones before her just do so much work dealing with the public and stuff. And from a budget standpoint, since tonight's budget night, have saved us a ton of money and treated people so respectful and helped us. And so she knows, because I've dealt with her for so long and I've already told her, she knows how much she means to me. And so on behalf of this board, you are welcome to make comments. I know some of you have already talked to her, but we are so fortunate, and the citizens, when you walk out this door tonight and pass all those people, 99.9% of them will have no clue what you have done, but we do. And we appreciate enough to make up for that other 99.9%. So thank you. No, you have been wonderful, and we mean that. Anybody else want to say anything?
Oh, just one sentence. Not only did you make us look good, you made us feel good. You always had a smile. You always just uplifted us, when we were down. So I just thank you for all of that, and we will miss you.
I know it's weird that I would be speechless. I know.
Let the record reflect.
you won't have to take one. No, I just sincerely thank you for always being so great with responding to our emails and phone calls and taking care of us. Yeah, even on Sundays when I say don't respond today, it's just I'm working today. You don't have to respond, but she does. And even from before I was on the board, she would set up stuff for me so I'd know and I'd be prepared as I could be when I got here. So thank you so much. I appreciate you. I mean, I think they've said it all. And I'm just going to blow you and Mike a kiss and wish you the best.
So I might get emotional, but I've never had a secretary before or anyone I could call. So from day one of me being on the board, you were the first person to welcome me with a smiling face. Anything I can get you, any questions you have, like literally I would ask you something that I think I was supposed to ask Kurt and you knew the answer. I'm just so unbelievably grateful for you. Like Ms. Bodwin said, you answer a text on Sundays, like, hey, don't answer me today, answer me tomorrow, but you're there. And I always knew where I needed to be in regards to FSBA. I never had to deal with any of that, and you were always my go-to, so I'm really grateful for you, and thanks for sending me all those cards in the mail that I need to send out. So be ready. Yeah. I appreciate you. I'll miss you.
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Kathy's going, do I have to work on Sunday?
No, you do not have to work on Sunday.
Don't have to respond, just because we...
No, thank you.
Thank you.
We are honored. Mr. Gadd.
Well, technically... You all know Peggy was my secretary.
Yes.
But she suffered
through
that.
And I said all I needed to say yesterday, but I will add an additional comment. I'm glad I won't have to listen to those therapy sessions she was doing with the superintendent anymore. I hope you all got a note in the mail. You were invited September 9th. You should have got a complimentary card to a fundraising event at the IPAC Center. Did you get that, September 9th? Okay. That's a busy time of year, so don't feel obligated to come, but you were invited because of your role in making that theater happen. So you're certainly welcome to attend. I think there are some other things going on in the district, but at that time of the year, it's kind of hard to find a free date. Yeah. But please put that on your calendar if you can make it.
Yeah, luckily the other event is the Star Award, it's at the Wesley Chapel High School. So.
Mm-hmm. That night?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's so it can we can kind of fly between one and the other.
Mm-hmm. That's it for me.
Is that it?
That's it.
Mr. Shibley.
There is an addendum to item 11.1 that has been uploaded into board docs, and I have nothing else on the agenda this evening.
Ms. Cain.
Good evening. Lots of exciting things happening in the operations departments and schools right now, and from beautiful renovations, our new Starkey K-8. Looking at the Hudson Complex is looking great, other construction projects as well. We also welcome back 10-month employees this week. We have transportation, bus drivers, and assistants coming back tomorrow and Friday for in-service. Next week, food, nutrition, services, so we're excited to welcome them back. And then I also just wanted to say a thank you to Peggy and wish her the best in retirement. She's been a great friend, and I'm still in denial, so I'll be looking for you.
Ms. Swenson, anything else tonight from you?
Yes, sir. Item 13.2, I have a change. it is approving the Investment Oversight Committee members. Mr. Phillips has called us this week and let us know that he will be moving to Georgia, so he will no longer
He's going to do it?
That's the message I got. So we will be looking for another member.
Randy. Okay.
Any of you can recommend it, but if you can.
So we need to delete his name from that
yes.
list on 13-2.
Yes,
okay.
Thank you.
Got him. All right. Ms. Hill?
Yes, good evening. Well, despite all of the other issues we are dealing with, what a great week we've had engaging with teachers and leaders at Together We Learn. Just 2 days down so far, 1 day to go. We've had over 2,200 awesome educators join 223 sessions so far to prepare them for the coming school year. And we so appreciate their time, their dedication to their own professional growth. On their own time during this last week of summer break, we have the best teachers anywhere, and we appreciate your support of them. I also had the pleasure, along with the superintendent, of welcoming our newest Pasco instructional staff members to the district on Monday during new teacher induction. We got to meet teachers and student service staff members, almost 300 in both groups, and we're so grateful that they chose Pasco and know they will be the world-class educators we need in front of our incredible students. Additionally, I wanted to just provide a little reminder. Mr. Browning did say, while the state will not allow us to offer My School Online this year, for any families wishing to engage in a virtual option, we do have our nationally recognized Pasco eSchool. And I've heard a few folks say we don't have another option, and we do. As a full-time or part-time virtual education for any families, I don't want any students or parents to think that we do not have an option if their choice is not face-to-face or brick-and-mortar. At Pasco eSchool, you know you're a Pasco County student, and you are taught by Pasco County teachers.
Ms. Holton, can I ask a question about that really quick? Mm-hmm. I had somebody ask me, so say their child's enrolled at one of our in brick-and-mortar schools. They don't need to have school choice to go into eSchool, do they? That window doesn't have to be open. They can just enroll if they qualify?
They just fill out the registration application.
Okay, cool. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Speaking of school choice, I know that the board has been interested in the most recent Pasco pathway numbers from the last window. And so as an update, we had 273 secondary applications, 355 elementary applications. Parents still have some time to make their acceptances. And so after that, I'll be able to provide updated numbers by school. Lastly, I want to let you know that we have Suzanne Legg from Dayspring Academy to represent item 10.2, should you have any questions on that. And a big thank you and many blessings to Peggy.
Mr. Chairman, just to tag with her, I had the opportunity to speak with Ms. Wolin's early childhood program staff this morning. Welcome them back. I think about 160 folks, you said, that were on the call. So I was glad to get them back in the saddle again as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Heschler-Nerder?
Good evening. I'll just briefly add on from the school perspective. While we are certain that there are very uncertain days ahead of us, we are also quite certain that we have the most fantastic leaders in place, and they are busily preparing for a wonderful school year for our students and staff. Many welcoming events will take place this Thursday for 6th grade and 9th grade, as I mentioned last week. Kinder camps have been going on all across the county, and they are just ready for everyone to come back, teachers and staff on the 3rd and the students on the 10th, and we're excited for a wonderful year.
Thank you. Dr. Iles? Dr. Skanga? All right, thank you. So, board members, we move to the consent agenda, and notes I have are a correction on 9-1, the out-of-state travel, an addendum for 11-1, and a correction removing the name of Randy Phillips from investment oversight on 13-2. Is there any other corrections or anything you want to pull? All right, with that, I'll entertain a motion with those three.
Move to approve with those three.
Second.
Motion by Crumley, second by Armstrong. Any discussion? All in favor signify by aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. So we move on to 16, the policy update, volume 21-1 and 21-2, final approval. We've gone through the workshop. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved approval.
Second.
Motion by Armstrong, second by Bodwin. Any discussion? All in favor signify aye.
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 Motion passes. Thank you. Individual board member reports. We'll start at the other end. I started. Want me to start again?
No, I can.
Okay.
You just always change it, so I'm not sure.
I know. Y'all are always
we're not saying, good with
you're,
change.
Okay. I'm just trying to change it.
So I had the opportunity last Thursday to visit Marjorie's Hope Teacher Store with some of my colleagues. That's located at Wendell Crannon, room 129. You can find details for when it's open for our teachers on Facebook, on their Facebook page. But this is a store where teachers can go and they can shop for free. And it's not just paper, pencils, construction paper. It's like borders for your bulletin boards and posters and little timers and calm down corner fidgets and treasure box toys. So it's such a blessing for our teachers. And I was just so excited as me being a teacher myself, walking around and just feeling so grateful. For what they're offering our teachers to really use in their classrooms. And I just wanna thank Debbie and her amazing team for always figuring out where there's a need and fulfilling it. And then, as I was reflecting, we're starting a new school year, and just this time of year, there's just so much excitement, but I know that it can also bring some anxiety. So I just wanted to remind our teacher, staff, and admin, here we go. I hope that you had some time this summer to refresh, to re-energize. In the next few weeks, I just want to remind you that you're going to be opening your door to some new faces. They're going to see your beautiful classroom and all the hard work that you've put in to get ready. I know that there's still some anxiety about this year, but I know that you're all your hard work and your love that you put into your classroom is recognized, that your students are going to be so excited. So as you prepare, I know many of you already have all summer, but remember, I'm in your corner. I'm cheering you on. I cannot wait to come and visit and see all the amazing things that are happening. And if you ever need anything, know that I'm here. To our families, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for supporting our teachers for this new school year starts. I've seen so many different Amazon wish lists posted and different items of postings of the community supporting our teachers and our staff. So I want to thank them for that and for their kind words that are being shown. And I want to thank you for entrusting us with your children. I'm just so unbelievably excited for this new school year because I know it's going to be so wonderful. And that's it.
Ms. Conley?
Okay, so just to acknowledge that we won't be, well, our board meeting, next board meeting comes after the start of the school year. I just hope everybody finishes up really nicely this summer, has a good time, those of you that are off. And just a few thoughts. You know, we got through last year. Last year was probably the weirdest year ever for many people in school. And I'm just still so proud of our district, how we managed to get through it, and everybody really worked together and came up with creative ideas and innovative ideas. And we're going to get through this year. We're off to a little weirder start than we had hoped for, but we're going to be fine. I believe it. And we just have to try to be as flexible as we can, and that's parents, students, everybody, and we can do this again. I don't think it's going to be as bad. I hope I don't regret those words, but I don't. I think we're going to get through it fine. And I wanted to say a special thank you to Mrs. Coons over here because she had some transportation challenges that she has really gotten us through. And things that go unsaid around here, people don't know, but she really has made some things happen. And without transportation, our kids wouldn't even be getting to school. So I really want to acknowledge what you've been doing and fixing. So thank you.
Ms. Bowman?
We talked at our last meeting about our legislative platform, and that hopefully I think we're going to discuss it in our August meeting. Regarding the legislative delegation that we all got emails about, Mr. Altman, as chair, are you going to speak at that?
We're talking about that.
Okay.
We talked about it yesterday and still trying to decide how we... I've met individually with some of them as recently as a couple weeks ago, and so we may go a different route, but we're going to have somebody...
Okay.
There.
Somebody's going to be there to represent us.
Yep.
Okay. And then I, too, attended the Marjorie's Hope School Store grand opening, and our community truly is blessed to have Debbie and her team of volunteers because they do provide so much support. So I want to thank them again. And also mention that the Pasco Education Foundation said that I talked to Stacy on Saturday, and she said they are also in the process. They've been working on trying to get some sort of a school store set up for our teachers that they could visit on a regular basis and shop for free there as well. So that'll be nice to have more than one location. On Saturday, I attended the first annual, so it's going to happen again, new teacher welcome event at Starkey Wilderness Park. So thank you to everyone who planned and participated. I think Leah said the person's name is Charlotte. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Well, she did a great job. It was her brainchild, I believe. And then everybody came together, including our community partners, the Education Foundation, Suncoast Credit Union. So I just wanted to thank her and everyone who worked together to put that on. It was a great event. There were a lot of volunteers there from our schools, and it was so nice to have that big welcome to Pasco County for our teachers and their families. So thank you for doing that. And then I wanted to just ask if you could sometimes share, I assume we've got the results on the general paper scores. Could we? We don't? Oh, I thought that those came out in July. Well, it's still July. Not yet. Okay. Well, when we get them, I would like to. I'm curious. I know it was a weird year for us to be trying something new, so I don't know what the expectation is, but I am curious. And then just to wish everyone a great start to the school year. Thank you all so much for being so flexible and continuing to work 24/7 on these plans.
All right. A lot has already been talked about the new teacher welcome event I also attended. And it was fun just to have a chance to say hello to and welcome the new teachers to Pasco. And I thought it was just a great opportunity for the new teachers to get to know some other new teachers so they can kind of form some networking support. Because first year of being a teacher is tough, as I still remember. So it was a really, really great event. And then I did go to the Marjorie Hope ribbon cutting. I think a lot of people don't realize just how much they do. They are opening up a store for clothing for Pasco County school employees. It's this Friday and Saturday in Newport Richey. So that's another chance that they're going to be sharing and helping the teachers and employees of our county, along with all the backpacks and school supplies that they were sending out to all the schools. That they were putting together. Then I remember so well this time last year when we were faced opening a new school, opening school back up. We really didn't know what we were doing as far as COVID protocol. I mean,
we were scared to death.
What did we need to do? How much cleaning supplies did we need? How many times a day did you have to wipe down the desk? I mean, there were so many unknowns last year. And I just remember going through some of the schools right during planning week, right before school opened, and talking to the teachers. And in spite of all of that, they were so excited to see their kids, to see the new kids. They just couldn't wait to be back in front of our students again. So I know that's going to be the same this year because that's what you do at the beginning of the year. You just so much excitement to be back in the school in front of your kids. So I just wish them the best. I wish the students the best when they come back in, and some of them haven't been in the school
for a whole year, so it's going to be kind of like going to school the first day. So it's going to be exciting for everybody, and I just wish them the best and hope they have a very safe and successful year.
Mr. Alfonso.
I don't have any substance for the board, but I did want to just join everybody and echo those comments about Peggy, who I'll miss, and just say thank you for all of the times that you helped me cover those rough patches, as well as to say that you've always been so pleasant and positive despite me. Thank you.
So. Kept your car keys, I think, a couple times to make sure that you signed papers.
All right.
More covering up, huh?
We go to public comment for non-agenda items. Mr. Alfonso.